tea time. So our next presentation by Professor Jim Lee.
I'm here to talk about three-dimensional finite volume non-hydro static cathedral model developed in our lab. Our lab is people quite often mistakenly in as a compartment car, but this is actually in Boulder. It's just a 5 minute drive from one car. We are at NOAA. And then we are at the Earth System Research Laboratory, ESIL. ESIL is a relatively new laboratory. It's as a result of NOAA OAR, Oceanography and Atmospheric Research Reorganization. In the early 2000s, we used to have in the OAR 12 laboratory, like GFDL, AIL, AOML. Now in the Boulder, there is five laboratory. Consolidate into this super laboratory into four division. And so in our new lab, this is our modern goal, is to develop a non-hydrostatic cathedral global model for weather and climate prediction. So if you think of the weather forecast, it's an initial value problem. The predictability typically currently is limited within 2 weeks. On the other hand, climate projection is a forcing problem. It's a decadal and millennium projection. A modern modern NWP model uses a non-hydrostatic limit area model, which is suffered from the later boundary limitation and problem. And the coarse resolution hydrostatic global model is used in the climate model. So in the last decade, there is a trend of this NWP model running with larger and larger domain in order to avoid the later boundary problem. At the same time, this climate models hydrostatic is running at higher and higher resolution to improve this GCM cumulus parameterization. That's why there is a lot of effort to have this unified approach, which is use a global non-hydrostatic model to resolve tropical convective cloud system or explicitly permit large scale convective cloud. So this is weather and climate connection intra-seasonal. So our goal is really is try to use the same model, integrate from for the NWP and extend into the intra-seasonal for MJO. And so we decide to construct our model based on iCathedral grid. We did this in from early 2000. Compared to the traditional LLM model, for the same number of grid points, iCathedral grid has a better resolution in the tropical. And then also, the important thing for me, my personal, is iCathedral has this one-to-one neighborhood. It's really suitable for finite volume flux calculation. So in order to reach this global non-hydrostatic, we decide to take a two-step. First step, we develop a hydrostatic one, which we call finite volume iCathedral model. It's when the target resolution is greater than 10 kilometers. At that time, almost 10 years ago, the goal is to, by the way, our job is to help NSET to improve the weather forecast. So the initial FIN project was try to participate in NSET as a global model ensemble, because the best model is not coming from single model. The best forecast is actually coming from an ensemble of a different model, that were good model. And then that FIN recently has passed this NSET verification matrix, will be running at NSET as a member of ensemble. And then we are continuing to extend the FIN model into a mean non-hydrostatic model. Target resolution is on the order of 1 kilometer. So next I will go through with you quickly about the feature of our icosahedral model, and then I will focus on the non-hydrostatic one. Both of FIN and MIM undertake that the final form integration and local coordinate. So I think it's doesn't come out. Probably out running out of battery. Okay. So the reason we use the local coordinate is instead of integrate this final volume line integration along this spherical curvature, it is actually 3D curve line. By doing the projection, we can just do in the 2D final volume on the straight line. It's much easier mathematically. Okay, good. Thank you. So for example, the vorticity will be just the two-dimensional vorticity will be just the line integration along the CRH, the inner product with the tangential factor. The divergence, according to the Gaussian theory, will be just the line integration of the wind product with this normal factor will be divergence. And then we also construct this conservative and monotonic flux corrector transport scheme. In the thing we use this so that the conservation and monotonicity is to make conservation right, to have the mass conservation, we need to satisfy this. And then to have the tracer conservation, we need to satisfy this. So basically, you can see we have rho and q, rho q need to be satisfied at the same time. And the monotonicity required dq dt equals 0. This is fundamental, and the consistency that this morning Henry was talking about, if you have q constant equal 1, it should be constant. So we build this into a Adam Bash was said older. The Zalasek scheme is actually very popular FCD scheme used in an atmospheric model. Unfortunately, Zalasek scheme is one-time level. And for the modern model, we all use this higher order. For example, Adam Bash was said older requires three time level, using the multiple time level to cancel the truncation error. So in order to do this multi-step FCD, we need to consider this multiple forcing, and that's what we do. So this is using that slot cylinder case that Henry showed this morning, the initial condition, and then after 12 days, at around the pole after 12 days, it's monotone. So basically, inside this is this continuous function. Inside there is no decrease, but on the edge there will be a smoothly decrease. We can look at this level, the cross section. the truly slot cylinder is discontinued. And the beauty of FCT is in a far away from this truly discontinued, it remains constant. And then depend on your model resolution, this discontinuity is replaced by the model resolution dependent smoothing. So fundamentally, because in a discontinuous function, the truncation error in here is infinity, because the derivative of discontinuous function is infinity. So there is no method can give you the discontinuous scheme you like. Unfortunately, the atmosphere will really discontinue, like cloud is a discontinue. So to me, FCT is really a good approximation to this discontinuous problem. If you really care about this, then you use the higher resolution. It will become, give you a closer and closer to this discontinuity without overshoot and undershoot. This is just slot cylinder. This is Poisson Bell. So once we have shallow water, we have conservation monotonic scheme, then we can put this together, becomes a hydrostatic. It's pretty straightforward now. But the theme is a so-called layer model. The layer model is, the layer thickness is allowed to be changed by that convergent or divergent by the flow. But most important thing for a layer model is you should not allow your layer thickness go negative. So once we have this monotonicity scheme, the layer thickness will never go negative, because in the hydrostatic model, delta P, the layer thickness in terms of pressure is a prognostic variable. And then if you use the monotonicity scheme, initially it's non-negative, it will maintain non-negative. So we have put this together and then we use FIM. FIM has been used to do the real-time forecast for many years. For I think it's about 5 years. So FIM has been perform medium range weather forecast twice a day in the 0 and 12 Z. We simply interpret GFS data to the ICAR screen. Hydrostatic initialization 7 days. So some initial condition to run service, we use that GFS physics package running at a similar resolution. FIM is running day in and day out at 30 kilometer resolution. So this is about 10 months. This is all slide. I'm sure GFS is much better now. So basically this slide simply show that FIM achieved the comparable forecast of 500 millibar ACC as GFS. If that 500 millibar ACC above this is FIM better, below this GFS is better. And now, for example, in this phase, there is a dropout, GFS dropout, but FIM seems to be better here. In other cases, GFS doing better in terms of dropout and FIM. So FIM is actually pretty complementary to GFS. What we found, that we have been running the FIM and compare with GFS and ECMWF. The interesting thing we found is, because we use the same initial condition physical parameterization, the first 3 days, GFS and FIM actually behave quite similar. But after 3 days, we start to see the storm location, for example, is quite often in between GFS and ECMWF. So we think that FIM should have a positive contribution to the GFS forecast, the score in the ensemble forecast. Because to me, this is a good opportunity that we run everything same as a spectral model. So this slide is probably 4 or 5 years ago, 2009, 4 years ago. So I plot this GFS precipitable water, 30 kilometer resolution, and compare with the final volume. This is compare the final volume of the production with spectral production. The flow is very similar, large scale wise, it's very similar. But GFS final volume is more coherent. GFS is less coherent. But here I would like to point out that this is before Henry's semi-Lagrangian scheme. So I have not compared with GFS current scheme now. And we also develop an efficient indirect Bertelsmann scheme for any unstructured grid, including Nicast grid, because one of the difficult in terms of unstructured grids, you don't have left and right. I used to do a Cartesian model, limit area model, I minus one, I plus one, very easy. But in Nicast, it's not that easy, especially if you want to run MPP. Can be very difficult. But we have developed this very general method. I think this scheme is used in the NCAS. Without it, C-grid will be more difficult to form. And we also starting a grid optimization for efficiency and accuracy. So I have been wondering about the wave reflection and how important of the grid smoothness in a GFS grid in terms of impact to the model solution that we was talking just 10 minutes ago. So this is the standard bisector recursive scheme. And then we developed this modified gray circle. And this is a spring dynamics. I was trying to understand what does spring dynamics do. At the time when we first working on the ICAS model, many people ask about spring dynamics. So this is the way I understand spring dynamics. For example, if you look at the standard ICAS screen, you can see this is a pentagon, top pentagon. And then away from the pentagon, it's very regular. But next to the pentagon, it's irregular. So if you compare with the spring dynamics, the way spring dynamics smooths this irregularity is by reduce this pentagon. So compare this to the pentagon is much smaller. By reducing the size of pentagon, now if you look this green line, going around this pentagon becomes kink. The spring dynamics, Atomita, he developed this scheme that attach the spring into each grid point and just let the spring push itself and iterative. After a while, it becomes this smooth grid. And then we look at I actually call the spring dynamics grid and then find that the spring dynamics is actually purpose is reduce this pentagon so that the grid line can go through smoothly because the pentagon is smaller now. This larger pentagon, it has to kink. So once we understand this, we don't need to iteration because the problem with spring dynamics is the spring dynamics becomes unstable for a high resolution grid. If the resolution grid is higher than 30 kilometer or 15 kilometer, spring dynamics process cannot converge. Without doing the iterative, we can just use a 3 parameter, reduce this pentagon. Now the grid is smoother. Test the case 5. When I first developed the ICAST model, shallow water, no matter what I do, I cannot make this case work if I don't put the dissipation. So this is without dissipation. And one day, I talked to Japanese say, why don't you use spring dynamics? Indeed, I use the spring dynamics. The same core everything is the same, without smoothing. Without smoothing, it's smooth. We not blow up. This is blow up after 10 days. After, so this is 15 days. Okay. And then this is our modified green. Basically, give a similar spring dynamics. I think the point is sometimes green is very tricky. Yeah. Okay, so next I will talk about min. So we extend from the fin into min by simply extend this two-dimensional line integration into the three-dimensional foreign integration. So basically in the min model, min by the way, is a height coordinate. So it's a height coordinate, and then every green, this is Gaffney equation. If you are familiar with Wolf, this is exactly Wolf Gaffney equation. So I joked that B.S. Kamau, I said, you know, I moved to the Wolf, and then they move away from the Wolf to the factor invariant form. Very interesting. So we basically, our mean is using the Wolf Gaffney equation on the high coordinate, and each green point is our control volume. And we also use this Jim Duty described in great detail that how to smooth the green lines, smooth transition in a model hiding the face. It's actually worked pretty well. So and we also construct this over mountain, for example, over ocean, this each cell can be a flat. But over mountain, we actually allow the three approximate the mountain is a three triangle. So basically, that means this triangle can be has a face different direction based on the true topography. So immediately, MIM has a much better resolution over topography just by doing this. So now I want to explain to you about how do we do this pressure gradient forcing. To me, when we go to the hydrostatic to non-hydrostatic, how we treat mountain is very important. Now, if you look, this basically this the traditional sigma current following coordinate basically means two things. Current following coordinate means we construct the ERV following the terrain, and plus using the Joule-Clamp's smooth interface. Current following also means this: it's approximate pressure gradient in terms of two terms. This two term, similar magnitude with a different sign. So just like it's this cause a great concern for NWP community. And so like our Ava model, try to deal with this by don't break this two term, just to integrate this term. But the way they do is they also change the shape. And recently there is a great effort trying to treat the pressure gradient over mountain using the Cassell. Again, Cassell is, in order to do this, Cassell has to has this kind of difficult shape. Can be difficult. So in the 3D final forum, we actually the things construct like a current following, but we do not break these two terms. We actually integrate at the finite volume based on the mountain. For example, the way this means the mountain is going this way, the mountain going up, that's why we have this direct volume grid like this. So if you have like a wind going up, going impinging on the mountain, we will see this going up, the pressure push, and then just by doing the three-dimensional finite volume, there will be this is always pushed back. We can relate it to this as the new concern is anti-force pushback. So we are very curious about how this approach. We are very curious about how this approach to the orographic presentation. So we are doing the horizontal explicit, vertical implicit without time splitting. I think that even though Jim Beebe said 4 to 6 times, but if you run that real model, the jet stream is easily 100 meters per second. So there is actually not much gain by using that time splitting, but also we also need to use the diverging damping. By using the horizontal explicit, vertical implicit is a tridiagonal solver, the Joe Clem's tridiagonal solver. And we use the Rankine-Kappa force solver for time discretization. And also an important new project is try to explore the use of GPU. So the speed of the GPU compared to traditional CPU is speed up very fast. So new model has been coded to run on both CPU and GPU. So next I will show you the new benchmark test cases like warm bubble. Let me show you the warm bubble. So warm bubble is a rising thermal in an isentropic atmosphere. So I did this to the left hand side, I did this to check our tridiagonal solver. So the left hand side is explicit. So we use a very, very small time step. And this is initial, it's a bubble, and then after 14 months, the bubble going up after 14 months. The explicit method actually show the wave is breaking because these are strong shear. Strong shear, the wave is breaking. On the other hand, that tridiagonal solver actually maintain that smooth solution. And as expected, because implicit show dump out the faster wave. Because of this, we decide to use this tridiagonal solver. And then the cold bubble, cold bubble going down and then hit the ground going out has a three rotor. This is a very typical mesoscale test case. When I was still young 20 years ago, I did this. But nowadays, there is more and more analytical test cases. So this is a DC mean dynamic cold model intercomparing project last summer. I will show you a couple of interesting cases. So this is analytical tropical cyclone simulation. We put the initial condition is just a prescribed vortex. And then if vertigo, it will go, and this is the wind speed every six hours because the data drift is going northwest. All of the DC mean model show the similar thing. Because this is running 120 kilometer resolution, the wind speed is not as big as what you would expect. And this is internal graph degree. To me, the difference between hydrostatic and non-hydrostatic, if you look at the eigenvalley, is there is a two internal graph degree eigenvalley. So it's very important to check this internal graph degree cases. So in this internal graphic, we can Google DC mean 2012. We will see, I think it's 18 model. Probably 18 model, right? So this is, in this internal graphic, this is time, this is longitudinal. Initial perturbation, and the perturbation going out, and that the wave propagate away from the center. If you look at this delta T, the reverse delta X delta T reverse is the phase speed. We computed the phase speed. It's about, I think, within, in this case, within about 2% of this analytical phase speed. And now more interesting now is that mountain wave. Mountain wave, the overall precipitation is hydrostatic matter has problem to get. And then in this DC mean, the mountain wave cases, the first case 2.1 is no vertical shear. This is vertical shear. Case 2.2 has a vertical shear about 16 meters per second. So this is no vertical shear. I pick this up from DC mean website. And this is smallest. Because it's impossible at this stage to run. This is, I think it's 300 meter resolution. So we have reduced 500 times Earth so that we can run small Earth. Since there is no correlated force, so it should be fine. And this is from the NGAM model. NGAM is a straight line. If you run NGAM, the line on the equator should be no problem, as indeed it should. No problem. This is a small scale mountain undulate to a mesoscale mountain. This is NGAM, this is German model icon, IOP. This is MPAS running at G5, and this is NIM running at G5. We actually running, this is running 300 meter, this is running 500 meter. We actually, both MPAS and NIM. And I don't know what icon. Icon is also icosahedral model. So this three is icosahedral model. This is the long model. And again, the long model, if you run in this analytical test case on the equator, it's fine. And all of this model show that the mountain wave immediately around the mountain is propagate perpendicular to the mountain. And away from the mountain, it becomes straight, just like a hydrostatic solution. This is no vertical shear. The interesting now is now if we have vertical shear, this is NGAM, this is ICON MPAS. Now you can see that this three model has vertical velocity over mountain, but ICON seems has problem to produce the very mountain wave solution over the mountain when there is a vertical shear. And if you look without vertical shear, ICON is doing very well as well. And so the ICON seems has problem at this part too. So I would say these three solutions are quite similar, and MPAS does need dissipation. Next, I will show you the physical package and upper planning simulation. So in the NIM, we have implemented two physical packages. One is GFS, it's an operational version from the NSEC. And then we also implement the green physics with help from Song Yu Hong. This GFS physics is more for NWP. We don't know whether GFS can behave well when we go to a 3 kilometer resolution. So we hope we can rely on the GRIMS, which is developed for running well in a wall in a 3 kilometer resolution range. So we are running an 800-day aquaplaning simulation with 240 kilometers, 32 vertical layer. This is from GRIMS. GFS show a similar result. But so we run this, and then we compare with Hoskin 1999, and this is NIM. Mean long wind from 60 to 360. This is from 1,000 to 100 millibar. We start from a state at rest. I like the upper planning simulation. It's really good to test the interaction between dynamics and physics. If you don't allow any surface sensible latent heat flux going up, everything will not happen. And this happened because this jet happened because that heat flux basically upper planet supplied the positive heat flux in the low latitude and downward heat flux in the high latitude. and that generates this saturation. Now the interesting is these two are actually very similar in terms of kinematic energy. It's a totally two different model, totally two different things. But in terms of like the kinematic energy, they are actually very similar. Since we from the Hoskin paper, we have only donor ring, so we compare with this. This is our vertical velocity. You can see upward motion in the tropical, downward motion in the latitude, and then at the low level lays over the tropic lays low pressure, and then above lays high pressure push this air back. So going convergence, divergence, high pressure, low pressure. So everything is dynamic consistent, and then you can look this from the thermal wind, it will give you this jet stream that we saw. Now, this is more interesting. It's, we are not only running the G5, now we run in up to 30 kilometers. We increase the resolution from 240, 120, 60 to 30 kilometers in a month. And so basically, you can see as you increase the resolution that precipitation increase, especially the convection. So basically, over the equator, it's really when the precipitation produced by the cumulus parameterization. This is just resolvable scale, you can see. When we go to from the low resolution to high resolution, the mid-latitude wind pick up quite substantially, even running at 30 kilometer resolution. But over the tropical sphere is really determined by like the cumulus parameterization. So I would hope that as Jim Didi showed this morning, when you run 3 kilometer resolution, you can finally do not rely on the cumulus parameterization. At the 30 kilometer resolution, you can see we still do not have enough precipitation over traffic. And I would also like to show this interesting mean sea level pressure superimposed by a precipitation. So color scale is precipitation. And this is, I think, every 20 days, each frame. It's mid-latitude, high pressure, and then lots of precipitation on the tropical. And then you see the prevalent, the storm form at the tropical start to move to the mid-latitude. You can see this low pressure. And then go to the high latitude and then dissipate. And then the dispersion wave moves differently. So that the wave catch up, the behind catch up like the wave ahead, continue to create this precipitation. So and then when I show this to my boss, Sandy McDonald, he said, this is very interesting. He pointed out to me, this, you know, this is all awfully very, this is just a crazy imagination. You know, we don't have land, we don't have everything, but the interesting, before I did this, I think, small scale is everything, but apparently, large scale is important too. And this is the real precipitation is this certainly there is no really this is no longitudinal preference, but this there is in the real world there is a longitudinal preference because of the topography. So my final remark is so we have developed this 3D final bottom and tested with benchmark. We were very curious to see how that pressure gradient force, especially higher resolution over topography, how does this impact that NWP or orographic precipitation? And then we have incorporated GFS and Grimm's physics into MIM dynamic code. Like I mentioned, MIM has running on CPU and GPU for efficient high resolution. We hope that by using GPU, we are able to run this global cloud resolving model at the 3 kilometer day in and day out. And now I'm in the process of doing this real-time weather forecast. Because now we have tested the dynamic code for large scale and small scale, and also tested the physics. We compare the GFS and Grimm's. They show a similar